What I'd like to do is, because some of you here might not know their work, what I'd like is for both of them to talk a little bit about their books and you know what they're about, so that you get a context when you're talking about finding their books. So, Jahnavi, would you like to go first?
Can you hear that? Thank you, Vivek. Thank you, Anushka. Vivek has already briefly mentioned what my work is all about. By profession, by training, I'm a medical doctor, but much retired now. I'm a writer now. So, and I began writing late. I began writing about 9 years ago. And I began with a collection of short fiction called Next Storm. And the story is about people, but they are loosely connected in a sense. They are all based in the Northeast and in Assam, the state I come from. They're meant to be about people, but they're about a lot of other things, about everything that goes on in Assam, has gone on for so many years now. The second was a novel, a book called Rebirth, which I wrote just to see what it felt like to write a novel. It was a slim novel, surprised me by going on to the Man Nation shortlist, the Commonwealth shortlist, and yeah, that took me by surprise. So I said, okay, I can write a novel. And then I went happily back to my short fiction after that. Again, it's a book about relationships. What I like to explore in my work, unanswered. Stuff you wouldn't talk about in real life, in day-to-day conversation, but you could easily explore in a piece of text, in a piece of fiction, is what I like to write about. And eventually, that is what life is, right? Human relationship, how you perceive people, what they see you as. What happens there is what makes the world go round. And of course, when you say human condition, human relationship, everything comes into it. Food, drink, language, dress, culture, politics, fights, great loves, betrayals. So my work is essentially about that. And I'll hand it over to Meena now to explain her work.
I don't know how I'll explain my work, but I think one of the reasons why I write is because I started writing 10 years ago. I was 17, 18 at that time. And I thought that's the only thing I could do about a lot of things. Like, you know, if there were caste atrocities, or if, you know, even I myself was feeling very oppressed or something. So I couldn't, you know, like really, I mean, I didn't know, at least, you know, these Naxalites were not advertising their movement in the big way, because otherwise I would have thought of going underground at that time. So I didn't know what else to do, so it's like, you know, I'm really helpless and I have to talk about it, so I start writing. So like today I was also telling Anushka, I think I wouldn't write if it were not, you know, to be political at all. So my writing deals with things that I witnessed growing up, and I still, you know, think are problematic in our society. So a lot of it deals with the caste system and how oppressive it can be, especially in my state, which has a very progressive outlook. It seems like it's one of the most progressive states. And I also write about and against matriarchies, because I find Tamil culture, you know, we talk about this huge history of, you know, 2,000 years unbroken tradition, the oldest living language in the world. We're proud of so much, but we are, I think, one of the most patriarchal societies also. So this is another reason why I write. And there's no reasons why, but these are things that I actually do write about. And the third is also that when I was growing up, Tamil, a huge part of all of our attention, daily attention, was about what's happening with the Tigers and why they had to do an armed struggle and what's happened to Tamils in Sri Lanka. So I mean, this kind of a politics also, you know, like informed me. And so I think my poetry deals with all these, you know, technically which are seen as real issues. And now I think sometimes it's very even difficult for me, because when you start writing on all issues, then people actually start demanding. So what do you say about the nuclear plant? So what do you say about, you know, this atrocity? What do you say about the bombing here? And then everyone expects a very political nature of the writing. So, but I think this idea of, you know, what I've seen around me and what are really difficult for me to digest, I think these inform my writing.
I can just add here what she said about what people expect you to write about, since she has a voice which is militant and, you know, thinking about politics around her. This happens to me so often, because people in the Northeast, they expect you to write about the insurgency, which I don't tackle head on, because really it's become kind of background music in Assam for us. And one generation has lived through it, 30 years has gone by. So it's in the background, we're all aware. I mean, there is a sense of tension sometimes, sometimes not. But I think the way to explore it would be to explore human life, to see how that, because of insurgency, people lost a year of school. People don't realize that because of the PSM movement. A lot of us lost a year of schooling. People have lost brothers. And this interesting thing I read recently to be from Assam is to have one person in the Alpha and another person to be killed by the Alpha, you know? Two brothers can be on different sides of the wall of the fence. So she's right, people expect you to write. I think as writers, we have the right to choose what we write about. Nobody can dictate it. And that's the beauty of being a writer of fiction. We're not journalists. This is not fiction, this is fiction. And I write about the lives and how life around us impacts us.
Yeah, so that's really interesting that both of you are in many ways rooted in the place that you come from and are very involved in the culture of the place. Still, your tone is very different. Like I read one of your reviewers, one of Jahnavi's reviewers described her work as the interior landscape of the woman. So, you know, it's very interior, the writing is very, it's very much the inner life. Whereas in Meena's case, of course it starts with the interior, but it's very much out there. It's very much about exposing that interiority to the reader. So how would you, could you tell us a little bit about the, you know, the kind of tone that you adopt in your writing?
I think the tone, I don't think you adopt it or it just adopts you. Because the tone of your writing is really what you are all about. It's your personality being expressed in writing and fiction. And it has to do with so many things. It has to do with you as a person, as to how you're brought up and what was expected of you as a child, how you interact with other people, your philosophy, your integrity, your moral values, everything. Everything and your culture, the place you come from. Because I always say this, and there are people from my place who disagree with me, but where I come from, the Northeast, is a kind of very gentle culture. It's I always say it's almost the tip of Southeast Asia, where everything is moderation. You know, the main thing is to be well behaved, no matter what. Keep calm and be well behaved. And women, of course, across the subcontinent, like she said, patriarchy expected to be soft-spoken and quiet, as compared to women, right, in other states. But in Assam, even the men are expected to be soft-spoken and quiet. So it's kind of equal. It's that don't cry in public, don't shout in public, go home and deal with it, is our kind of attitude. So that kind of set the tone for my writing, but that's the way I behave as a person. So like she said, interior landscape, a lot of people say quiet, which a lot of writers fight against that label of being quiet writer. But it is so. It is that we have very serious issues, very intense, strong feelings, but when we express it, you will probably feel that, oh, this is not really a big thing at all, but it is. And that's how we are programmed to express it, which is how we write, which is how I write, really.
You're talking about being well-behaved and, you know, not saying things that you're not supposed to say. I think this is the right cue to read your bit from this poem here.
I think a little short excerpt, which has actually got me into a lot of trouble, but I mean, one more reading is not going to cause any problem. This book is basically, it's called Miss Militancy. It retells all Hindu and Tamil myths in contemporary ways. So I just read a few lines. Telling my story another way lets me forgive you. Twisting your story to the scariest extent allows me the liberty of trying to trust you. I work to not only get back at you, I actually fight to get back to myself. I do not write into patriarchy. My Mariamma bathes for blood. My Kali kills, my Draupadi strips, my Sita climbs onto a stranger's lap. All my women militate. They brave bombs, they be little kings. They take on the sun, they take after me. I choose my words, coarse as the Kant Kannagi's colorful curses, chaste as a breast that burnt down a capital city. This tongue allows me to resist rape, to rescue my dreams. My language is not man-made, it's beyond the white-hot rules of your seminal texts. My language is dark and dangerous and desperate in its eagerness to slaughter your myths. My lines are feverish with the heat of the bodies you banish in your Manusmriti and Kama Sutra. Tamil woman that I am, I do not spare the ageist, classist, sexist, Tholgapiyam either. The criticism that I embark on, like your modification and like my cunt, is beyond all culture. Call me names if it comforts you. I no longer care. The scarlet letter is my monogram. I sew it on everything I wear. I tattoo it into permanence. I strive to be a slut in a world where all sex is sinful. I strive to be a shrew in a society that believes in suffering in silence. I strive to be a sphinx, part woman, part lioness, armed with all the little riddles. Come and riddle me. But be warned, I never falter in a fight. And far worse, I seduce shamelessly.
After such a strident, enthusiastic response, I just little defense about being soft-spoken and quiet, and that do not mistake the Northeastern soft-spoken for being weak. It's just that, you know, very strong women there. And a lot of gender equality, as you know. Women are taken very seriously in the Northeast. They have to pay a bright price to marry us. There's no question of dowry. We get stuff, we get goodies when we marry men. And so it's a very equal society, but you know, the quietness is strength. It's tempered strength, I would say.
See, the thing is that if I was writing my interior monologue or the interior landscape of the actual person called Meena Kandasamy, it will be like, oh my god, why has he not sent me a mail yet? Why is he calling me yet? Yeah, like, oh god, his eyes are so beautiful. I just wish I could look at him again. So when am I meeting him again? So it's a 95% of my interior landscape is moving love, yeah? So it will be just this very lovesick, love, not lost person. And I think nobody would like to encounter them. So, that's what some people don't like.
No, but it must have been a difficult decision for you from where you come from to actually come out with this poetry and put it out there. Did that decision to take this strident and defiant tone, was it a conscious
thing? You're living proof. So once when I read in Jaipur, and then the huge criticism on Facebook was, this is like a prostitute, you know, inviting her customers by reciting poetry. It's because they don't want the person, because the person, you know, conveys maybe sexuality, conveys anger, conveys, you know, actual, you know, fighting against the system. So they brought something like this. So I think it's much more than just words. If I just sit at home and write, you know, and never come up in appearance in public or don't use social media, they'll be very happy, I think. We have a revolutionary, you know, he just writes. She doesn't open her mouth about
things. Right. So clearly for you, writing is very much a political act, yeah. It is an act. So, whereas in your books, from what I've understood of your, what you've said and what I've read about your books, there is gender politics, but it's very understated, right? Because your second book is about, it's about a woman who is, she's talking to her unborn baby, and it's in a way a double birth, because the child is growing and sure. At the same time she is the woman herself, the mother is being kind of reborn. Is that would that be correct? Would you like to talk a little bit about the gender politics of your work?
There's always gender politics when you're a woman, right? So it can be strident or subdued, but it's always there. And yes, like you said in the second book, that's of course much more gender equal. I have many, many characters who are male. I speak very often in the male voice. But the second book, yes, because it's one protagonist and she's female. This is a woman who's facing a crisis in her personal life, and how does she deal with it? And having to deal with it takes her back to her childhood, to deal with issues she had long ago suppressed and sort of forgotten. But yes, in a way it is gender politics, in a sense of a woman trying to break out of something she feels trapped in. But I suppose because maybe this huge difference in age, Meena and I, the issues I deal with are a little different. Women in my book don't have that much time to simply read emails or, you know, lust after someone, because they deal with children and neighbors and, you know, mothers-in-law, sisters-in-law and other things, which again, such a huge part of our... So it's a different, but at every stage of our life, I mean, all of us know as women, right, as a child, a preteen, teenager, a young woman, starting to study, to work, to marry. Every stage is really not, it's uncharted territory for us, which is what I like to write about.
Sorry to be a little prickly here, but I have you been criticized for not being feminist enough, because the character in your book is kind of has accepted that her husband has abandoned her and has been unfaithful to her, right? And has abandoned her. Yeah, so he's not in her life anymore. And she is dealing with it, but as that's the difference between them. She's dealing with it in a very personally quiet kind of way, is that right? So did you get any flack from feminists, readers who felt that you weren't being feminist enough?
No, Anushka. On the other hand, if you read through the book, you realize that in the end, she hits back very hard. So I suppose I would say my Asmi's way of hitting back is subdued. You figure things out slowly, take it gently, and hit back. And I have a lot of critics and reviewers who say that, well done and great. And they want to go to the events of sequels. We want to see her next stage in her life coming. We want to see her like blossoming, breaking up. So, yeah.
I think I want to answer this question because this idea of, this women negotiating marriage is also very interesting, because I'm this hugely militant feminist, but then I suffered domestic abuse. I was married for 4 months, of which for 2 months I was undergoing domestic violence, and a lot of people, she's a feminist, I'm like, she could have walked out the next day, and then she knows politicians, she knows everybody. So, but I think, and what I realized also is that, yes, technically it could have happened, but when we are women and when we are in a relationship, especially when given how much we all valorize love and how much we want to make our relationships work, because that's another sign of success in the society that values only success. So I was putting my whole self into it and trying to make it work. I know it was not working, I was trying. And then I realized that, no matter what you are to other people, to a lot of other people out in the world, Meena Kandasamy could be a very strong voice, a strong feminist voice. But to me, when I was, I had this fight and I was thrown out of home, I didn't know a single person in Bangalore. Now I have friends who say I live in Mangalore, I'm a huge fan, but that night when I was thrown out of my house, I didn't know anybody, I didn't know whom to go to. So I think, as individuals, this you can be strong in life, but to be, can be strong in your writing, but this actual strength, this actual power, all of us are in that sense little locked, and we're also all the time, I think, in some cases, looking towards our mothers. And try, if my mom could make it work, or if my mom could put up with all that, so if my mom did that. So in some sense, we're trying to live up to them and live up to what they did. So we end up sacrificing, we end up being fools for sacrificing.
But also, what you said about being in a relationship and breaking out of it, even when something as hard as abuse happens, this is a beautiful story by Alice Munro, for Dimensions. I don't know if anyone read it. But that brings us up so beautifully, because there's this very young woman who's lost her mother, and there was this male nurse taking care of the mother in the hospital, who's obviously something wrong with mentally, who charms the young girl, marries her, and then locks her into this relationship where he takes every decision, which school the kids go to, and he's told her, don't talk to neighbors, don't carpool, talk to me first. He's locked her into this bubble. And one day she decides to break free, and just a small thing, she wanted to carpool with a neighbor, and he said no, she said yes, I will. And she walks out of the room with her two kids and goes to that particular neighbor, cries and shares, which is probably not allowed to do, and then she sleeps the night. And the neighbor calls her husband saying, it's okay, she's here, she's upset, she'll come back in the morning. And the guy is very calm, he says, fine, no problem, I'll see you in the morning. When she walks back, and the scene is so visual, I get goosebumps even now, the man is sitting on the steps and looks at her very calmly, he says, hi, welcome back, whatever. When she goes into the house, he has killed their two children. He has smothered them. And obviously then he's in prison, whatever justice takes over. But this young woman who then changes her name, goes into counseling, goes to work in a hotel, visits him every Saturday, because eventually she says, who else remembers the color of their eyes? The children. She shared that with him, right? They were their children, and eventually what taste of ice cream, what flower the child liked, favorite poems. So it's so hard on a personal level when it's your relationship with people, in a very intimate relationship of that level, a spouse, a mother, a child, a sibling, your very best friend. So hard to, you have to see every side of the person. So and you want to make it work. You really want to make it work. And women absolutely cannot. The story ends differently, I won't spoil it for you. But I look at this connection she has with him, because life goes on. A mother would forget what the child liked to eat, but this man would remember what particular pasta the child liked to eat. I thought it was very good way of showing that you cannot judge people. You don't know what's happening inside a relationship and what the stressors and what the liabilities and the obligations really are.
Yeah, I kind of followed the thing that you wrote after you went through that trouble with your marriage and all the responses to it as well, which were, there were a lot of, she got a lot of vitriol for having stayed in the marriage that long. So I know that must have been tough. But what I was wondering was that having, you just said that how at that point you just wanted to make it work and it was, so has that influenced your writing after that? Yes. Has that made you become less?
No. The thing is that with my husband, and this is why I actually tried to make it work, was that he was he had been underground for some time. He'd been in armed struggle, so he was revolutionary, and all the time we used to talk about revolution. So it's like we saw eye to eye on everything. Everything except I think the fact that his wife should share her emails. So, and that this kind of possessiveness and suspicion was the only point in which we could differ. Because otherwise, even if I myself made a person, I couldn't make someone so revolutionary. Like, this guy is like 4 years older than me. He's already been, part of a militant squad. He was unwanted. And he's also done a PhD on feminism. So, he was like really brilliant. Somebody quotes Marx and Foucault all the time. And, he knows how to trick you. And he looks handsome to top all of that. So, I would try to make it work. It's logic. You don't want to lose a nice man. But then you realize that, you can't cure a person who decides that he has to beat you in order to put sense into it.
No, what I meant was that, your writing has been strident, feminist, that...
I think it's got more stronger, maybe.
It has. So it's not caused you to therefore pause and think that, okay, there may be circumstances in which women would not want to... want to take on the world in that way. There may be certain sense like she described in the
past. No, my biggest burden was being me. My biggest burden was the fact that, she's okay, if I did this, I knew that people would say, writers are not in stable relationships. Female poets are like this. Or they would say, women who talk about feminism, they marriage is just a common thing for them. So I knew that all this would come and I didn't want it to come. It's so easy to sully an entire profession because of one person's behavior. So it's like, this is the first thing they would say. Nobody would say, she's a problematic. I don't think it would come individually to me. They would say, yeah, women writers are like that, who's been in a stable relationship, who's had a stable marriage. So it would become so easily generalized, and it's like, it's like women in the public sphere, or what happens to women in politics, like everybody's, talks about them. So in that sense, it's very close to that, because I'm not only a writer, I'm also very an activist.
Very much an activist. Also, the other element in your poetry is your Dalit identity. So that how does, how you...
generally?
Yeah, generally, is there any work of yours that specifically addresses that?
Yeah, in the beginning, I think, maybe when I started out 10 years ago, it's very different. The way I would look at caste now is really different. I understand now that class plays a huge role because of I'm much more privileged than anybody else. Like, both my parents are professors and PhDs. So in what way can I claim to be a Dalit in the same way in which a girl from a Basti or a slum or a Cheri can claim to be? So there's this huge gap in which I'm empowered to speak, and I'm empowered on so many levels. So if I say that I'm not empowered or I underwent the same kind of upbringing, no. I would not share that. And again, even within the Dalit movement, I think I've been called into question for what I think is my identity, because my mother is backward caste and my father is a second generation product of intercaste marriages, because he belongs to this community of verbal soothsayers and witch doctors. So these men, I'm now understand where my father's roving eye comes from, is that these men, my great grandfather, he eloped with a lady. And they went and settled in, they settled in another village. And then my grandfather eloped with this girl who was the daughter of the court poet of Ramanathapur. So evidently the girls are caste. This man meets her in a market. I think she's 20-something, and then he's 40-plus. He runs away with her and he settles down. And I also think that these people, again, within the Dalit movement, it's also difficult because this community of herbal soothsayers, witch doctors and soothsayers and priests, they're basically priests for Dalits. They pride themselves on the fact that they are vegetarian for 3 months in a year. They pride themselves on the fact that they're priests for Dalits. So you're a Brahmin Dalit, you know, within the Dalit hierarchy. So you look down on all other Dalits as well. And this is my great grandfather, so that's my grandfather married again. And then I'm like possibly, you know, like 1/8 or 1/16 of this caste and all this other caste. So sometimes I'm like, what am I? How are you going to classify me? So you're 1/16 something, you're 1/8 something, and then, you know, it's crazy. And again, this entire thing, so what the lot of Dalit people say, how is she Dalit? I mean, like, evidently they want to dismiss the fact that I'm a Dalit. So do you actually stay there and fight and say, I'm Dalit? No, I want to prove this to you. Or say, okay, fine, I'm like really concerned, and this is my story. I'm not going to make up this entire story. Or my father's very alive, right? And he's not going to, I mean, like, if he's an upper caste man, he's not going to ask his daughter to make this fiction about herself. So, if you're not a majority community that is like Chamara or Mahara, you know, like whatever, Paraya or whatever is, then you don't have an entire movement to back you up with. You know, if you're one of them, then they're like, she's our girl. Like, you're a Brahmin priest for Dalits. I mean, like, you're a priest for Dalits? No, you're already suspect. And that also only your great-grandfather? No, God, we're not having you anytime. I know why I'm vital, you know, evident living proof that the caste system is not going to work. Because if people are having inter-caste marriages like this, I mean, after generations, then who are you? Who do you identify yourself with? And does the system make any sense at all? And also to talk about this, I mean, when I was younger, I really would believe in it. Okay, this is my caste. Now I'm like, to talk about it is so shameful because, I mean, okay, my mom, she's alive, I don't want to sully her name, but what about my grandmothers? I'm sure they were sleeping around with a lot of people. I mean, if they're anything to go by what I was. And, you know, the part of the country I come from Tanjore, which had, I think, the Dutch came in, the Danish came in, the Portuguese came in, the French came, then the British came. So you have all these visiting white men, you have the Arabs and the Chinese, and you have some other men, and you think they were only sleeping with people of their own caste? No. Some ways not look at colonialism as this bad thing, but say, okay, fine, at least it's prudent their caste system in some ways.
There's this thing of the validity of your voice is something that I think writers who write in English face all over. Do you find, Jahnavi, have you found that as problems that people are, you know, if you're writing about people from different social classes, do you find that difficult to do? You were talking a little earlier about how you represent their voices in your stories. How do you do that?
So Anushka asking about real life job, right? Fiction. Yeah, right. I think number one, like I was telling you earlier, is that you have to be very rooted in your own language. All of us are bilingual. So when I'm writing about a short story, obviously somebody from a village or a semi-urban area is not going to speak in English. But when I write, I'm already a translator because I'm writing their dialogue in English. But it's amazing. A fellow writer of mine from Northeast, she lived in Akum, and she said, you know, I felt like I was reading it in Ohomia English, Assamese English. That's a great compliment because how you do it, I think when you work at it, it comes unconsciously to me. I don't really work at it, but the structure, the grammatical structure, the tone, the stridency of a sentence, maybe an Assamese woman would, after some abusive word, would pause before retorting, that pause, and then she answers back in a very mild sort of voice. So that is Assamese to me. So, and that is translated in that fashion to English, really. So that's how I think we deal with it, because when you're writing in English, I mean, straight away you're translating, because obviously all your characters are not going to be speaking in English. But it has to be so credible that the reader kind of, it slips past the reader that, hey, this person could really be speaking English. So that is how I do it, really. Meena?
I think I answered.
So I just wanted to ask Meena again, because Meena has written her first novel. So we were just interested to know you were talking about how different it is writing a novel as compared to writing poetry. Meena, if you could share that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so this novel I started writing in 2009, and it's where I come from, Tanjavur district again, where I told you the nice availability of men. Yeah, so the fact is that it's one of the most, it's the rice bowl of Tamil Nadu, and almost all the rice that we eat in my state is coming from Tanjavur, but it's also one of the most feudal places in the whole world. And so there's a long history. I mean, if you have 1,500 years of uninterrupted rice paddy cultivation, then you understand the history of feudal, you know, land relations there. So what happens is that in 1968, on Christmas Day, this is the beginning of the communist movement, you know, Dalit laborers, agricultural laborers are getting organized, they're asking for higher wages, and the exact higher wage they're asking is basically two or three handfuls of rice, which is half a measure of paddy. So, and the landlords say, we are not going to give it to you, you have to stop being communist, you have to stop protesting, you have to stop, you know, like talking back to us and all these things. And so what they do is, on this one particular day, they attack the Cheri, this village of Kilvanmani, and they burn to death 44 Dalits, women, children and old people. So the men have all run away. So I mean, and for me this was, I think that after independence, this is the first major caste atrocity in India, that 44 Dalits were burnt alive to death because they were asking for handfuls of rice, yeah, as wages. And I think I had to write about it because this is where I come from, and it's also beautiful because in the 1960s was the, you know, early rise of communist movement in this district where my father is from. My father himself is named, Kandasamy is named after Manali Kandasamy, who was a fugitive underground communist leader. You know, he had a price on his head for some time, things like that. So this was in one way, even though I'm not exactly from the same village, this was one way of, you know, telling the story of where I am from. Because unless, you know, I read a lot of, you know, I read a lot of Indian English novels, things like that. So when I look at all of that, I was missing in them. Even though my lifestyle would be similar, I was like, no, this is not me, this is not mine, this is not mine. So I knew that I had to write a novel, but I went to the village a couple of many times, spent like the last 3-4 years going there back again and again. I read about 700 research papers just to understand what the feudal system is and what the communists were fighting and how the land laws changed under the British and all these organizing things. And I also read a lot of books. But for me, I mean, I tried everything, but the whole problem for me was, one, I was a poet, so every sentence had to be structured. I couldn't put an extra word anyway. It's almost like, because I think I'm so, I don't control my... Because I don't control my life in a big way, I think I'm extremely like a control freak with my words. I choose them so carefully, I write very slowly. So every sentence I had to work very hard at it, and then it's not easy, it's not poetry. Like 4,000 words is one poetry collection, but a novel has to be like 1 lakh words. So where are we even going to get there? And at several points of time. And also the biggest challenge for me was, I had to do something that was not going to bore me. If I could see where it is going, then I would have tried it. If I knew I can predict it, I would have tried it. So I had to do something that was very challenging for me, something that I would not give up midway because, you know, okay, this is boring, or I know how the story is going to work out. So it was, I think as a poet, it's really, after I finished the first novel, I was like, one, I was feeling like, God, because I created this village and people and all these things and stories, I thought, oh, I've managed something that I can never manage with poetry. But on the other hand, I was really telling everybody I met, this is my last novel, this is my first novel and this is my last novel, I'm not going to write again because, my God, poetry is such a cakewalk. Who would want to sit for, you know, like, sit for days on end with these characters, sit in one place? I mean, you really cannot be indisciplined and be a novelist. You need a self-discipline. I think that would be
good. Just discussing this recently at another forum wherein they asked me the difference between short fiction, that's my passion, and novel. And it's not easy to write a short story, in case any of you think. So sometimes it's tougher because sometimes one short story sometimes takes me 5 months to write. But at the same time, a novel, you have a lot of time, a lot of latitude, a lot of word space, and you can, you know, really string it together. But no, there the struggle is to keep the tension and to keep coming back to it and being persistent and keep the characters alive and fresh. And it's really like, you know, really, it's a cliche, but a sprint and a marathon, you know. The short story has that intensity and power and the moment of transformation, what you're looking for. But whereas a novel will grip you for some time, and it takes a lot of patience really for inspiration to write. So between short fiction and the long form, my experience in between poetry and the long form, big jump for her, you know, her experiences.
Any questions?
Questions
from the audience?
A question to follow up from the last thing that Jahnavi Barua was saying. This is about the short story and the novel. You already described the difference between them. What I'd like to ask you is, how is it that you have developed a clearly stated and strong preference for one form over the other, and have you been helped in this by the fact that in India, unlike in the West, the short story is rated much higher and is far more popular and can make reputations, while apart from Alice Munro and one or two others, in the West, short story would not do that for you?
You're right, absolutely right, sir, because especially in our vernacular Bhasha languages, and I come from Assam, so I read in Assamese and in translation, the short story has a special place. For us, the puja specials, Durga Puja time, everyone waits for that supplement to come out. I mean, the major writers, all aside, they can make young Peter Wallis, but who put that one short story into the puja special? I think for me, I'm a doctor, so and my work has been described as being very minimal. And Anushka didn't ask me, I'm so glad, because everybody says, how does your medical training impact your writing? It does, in the sense that I'm very to the point. I appreciate brevity and yet a complex sort of minimalism. So that short story satisfies me intensely.
Would you say that? Novels are like allopathy and short stories like homeopathy?
Maybe it's the other way around.
Just like to add, what Nirmal Verma had once said, short story is born out of a desire to expand on a poem in the narrative prose of novel.
I do agree. I do agree.
Hi, this question is for Meena. I want to know whether there has been any backlash from any of these groups, you know, the morality keepers, like in Bangalore, they go against people that party, and we know that earlier, decades earlier, one of the poets who was very graphic, she had to go underground for years together. You know, I'm talking about Kamala, guys.
No, I understand what you say, but I think the backlash is because of social media. It's not like they have to come to the street, you know. They actually do write all this very horrible stuff, and I'm secretly pleased. I mean, I really wish I had the love life they attribute to me. Yes, seriously, I wish all the gossip was true. I mean, I really wish I did all those things they accused me of doing, yeah. But a friend of mine was once telling me, the big thing that you've done is that you've radicalized a lot of bimbos.
That's how they would like to dismiss me, I think, yeah, because whatever. Any more comments? I was actually curious what this year, Meena, you just joined the festival. This year we have an exceptional mix of people from Kashmir joining us. I was wondering, actually, Afsana, you are in the media also, what you thought of finding this thick, this message of finding in my voice? Whether there's something you would like to contribute to this, because it must have been also something for you to find your voice as you had. Well, you know, we're talking about finding my voice, and you were two examples, outside examples. Yeah, I wanted to ask the same question to you, and in hearing their stories, two very different stories, whether there was something that you found resonant also.
Well, with regard to that, I have a question regarding these widows and half-widows. Basic purpose of that book was to give a voice to the voiceless. Because there also I felt that these women, these widows and half-widows, their voices, they go unheard. They have problems. Governments are not taking the issue. Government is not taking the issue that seriously. Civil society is not that sensitive. It's turning insensitive towards them, even their own families. Even their own families or other organizations, they are not that much concerned about their issues, about their problems. So I thought that I have a journalist background, I was a journalist, I spoke to these women, got an opportunity to visit to them at their respective places. So I thought, why not to give advice to their concerns, to their issues, so that
it is a sort of a platform where from this voice can emerge that, see, they are the women who are facing a lot of problems, be it on the financial level, be it on social front, be it on the political side. So, and as a result, once that book was out, once it was published last year, after that there were a number of books followed. And there were so many research, because that was the ultimate purpose, that once something will be there, people will come forward. And once people will come forward, because usually this is such a problem where we need opinions. And once people, they share their opinions, only then that way out can be found out.
You are doing as women writers, you're using different means of getting yours. No, but and you have to accept that the voice is very different when you speak as a woman. And I don't think there's getting away from that. There's no need to be classified as a woman writer. I know all of us hate that. But what I mean is that the way she's done it is a particular way, and the way Meena does it is different, the way you do it is different. But what's common is, yeah, we all have to find our own voice and to get our message out there. So I think we should stop here because we're ready for the next session. Thank you so much, both of you. It's been really lovely.